half a league onward. All in the Valley of Death rode the 600. Forward the Light Brigade, charge for the guns, he said. Into the Valley of Death rode the 600.
Half a league, half a league onward. All in the Valley of Death rode the 600. Forward the Light Brigade, charge for the guns, he
forward
said.
Forward the Light Brigade,
into the Valley of
was
Death,
there a man dismayed?
Rode the 600.
Not though the soldier knew someone had blundered. Theirs not to make reply.
Forward
theirs
the Light
not to
Brigade,
reason why.
Was there
theirs
a man
not to
dismayed?
Do but die.
Not though the soldier knew someone had
into
blundered.
The Valley of Death.
There's not the to 600. Make reply. There's not to reason. There's but to do and die. Into
cannon
the
to the
valley
right of them, cannon to the left of them, cannon in front of them volleyed and thundered. Stormed at with shot and shell, boldly they rode and well.
Right of them,
into the jaws of death, into the
them,
mouth of hell.
In front of them,
rode the 600.
And thundered. Stormed at with shot and shell, boldly they rode and
flashed from their sabres bare,
the
flashed as they turned in air, sabring the gunners there, charging an
into
army while
the
all the world wondered.
Hell, rode the 600.
Plunged in the battery smoke, right through the line they broke. Cossack and Russian
flashed
from
all
the
their
sabres
sabres
smoke, bare,
flashed as they turned in air, sabring the gunners.
The Crimean War was a chapter in the Eastern Question and a prelude to the most important political development of the 19th century. It was the ambition of Russia that opened a new chapter in the Eastern Question. Russia was bent upon the control of the Black Sea and the Straits. She also looked upon herself as the historical successor of the Byzantine Empire. The Tsar was patron of the Greek Church, to which most of the Christian subject of Turkey belonged. It was his political mission to place the cross upon Saint Sophia. The ambition of Russia at the expense of Turkey was a constant factor in the Eastern Question. Tsar Nicholas I was firmly persuaded of the impending dissolution of the Turkish Empire. He declared that Turkey was sick man of Europe, who might suddenly die. In 1853, in the course of his conversation with the British ambassador, Sir Hamilton Seymour, he suggested partition of the Turkish Empire. England would have Egypt and Crete, and Russia might occupy Constantinople, although not in proprietary right. England politely but firmly declined the scheme. The maintenance of the Turkish integrity was the traditional British policy, and there was no desire to alter it. The conversation created a deep distrust of the designs of Russia. At this posture of events, a quarrel broke out between the Latin monks and the monks of the Greek Church over the custody of the holy places in Jerusalem. By the capitulations of 1740, the Roman monks had been regarded as under French protection. But during the atheistical days of revolution, the interest of France in the affairs of the monks declined. The Greek monks had encroached upon the rights of their Latin monks. The French Emperor Napoleon III took up the cause of the Latin monks and demanded full restoration of their rights and privileges. After some delay, Turkey conceded the demand. The Tsar Nicholas I immediately supported the Greek monks and insisted upon the withdrawal of the concession. Turkey attempted a compromise, which satisfied neither France nor Russia. In truth, neither France nor Russia wanted a compromise. The cause of the Catholic monks would appeal to the clericals of France, on whose support Napoleon III rested. It would awaken tradition as old as Crusades. If the contest led to conflict with the Tsar, a war should avenge the military defeat of Moscow. On the other hand, the Tsar sought to attain the traditional object of Russia's policy under the guise of struggle for holy places. Russia startled Europe in March 1853 by sending special envoy Prince Menchikov, the highest grandee in the Russian Empire. He demanded satisfaction with regard to holy places. In addition, he demanded a virtual acknowledgement of the Tsar's protectorate over all the Orthodox subjects of Turkey. The claim was based on the Treaty of Kucuk-Kanarji. It shifted the issue to a new plane. The Eastern Question was reopened. The British ambassador at Constantinople, Lord Stafford de Redcliffe, was convinced of Russia's dangerous ambition. With consummate skill, he disentangled the claims regarding the holy places from those concerning Russian protectorate. He persuaded Turkey to concede demand regarding two holy places and withhold the demand concerning Russian protectorate. Consequently, Menchikov and the staff of the Russian embassy left Constantinople in a huff. On July 21, 1853, a Russian force crossed the River Prut and occupied the principalities of Wallachia and Moldavia. It was declared not as an act of war, but as a material guarantee for the concession of just demands. The powers met in conferences at Vienna. The outcome was the Vienna Note, backed by the four powers, England, France, Austria, and Prussia. It attempted to solve the problem by a formula. It urged Russia and Turkey to accept the letter and spirit of the Treaty of Kucuk-Kanarji and Adrianople relative to the protection of Christian religion. Lord Redcliffe urged Turkey to insist upon a narrower definition of the term protection in Turkey's favor. Thus, he virtually overruled the decision of the four powers, including his own government, and caused the rejection of the Vienna Note by Turkey when it was accepted by Russia. The diplomacy had failed. Now the question could be settled only by the sword. Turkey called upon Russia to evacuate principalities, which Russia refused. On October 1853, Turkey declared war on Russia and took the offensive on the Danube. Russia Black Sea Fleet retaliated by completely destroying the Turkish fleet in the Bay of Sinope. It was not to be expected that war would remain confined to Turkey and Russia. Palmerston at the Foreign Office was all for vigorous measures. But Lord Aberdeen, the pacifist Prime Minister, held back. The popular feeling waxed white-hot at the massacre of Sinope. France, reluctant to move without England, waited uneasily. On February 27, 1854, a joint ultimatum was dispatched to Russia demanding the evacuation of the principalities. At the end of March, both countries declared war. Nicholas was convinced that England would not go to war. He also miscalculated the attitude of Austria. Russia had helped Austrian-Hungary Empire in suppressing Hungarian revolt in 1848. Moreover, she had supported Austria in diplomatic contest with Prussia at Olmutz in 1850. But Nicholas learned that gratitude did not weigh against political consideration. Austria viewed Russian occupation of Danubian principalities against her interest. Austria adopted threatening attitude towards Russia. On two occasions she delivered ultimata which Russia had to accept. Austria's hostile neutrality was of vital significance to ultimate Russian defeat. The Austrian ingratitude was not forgotten. It bore fruit in 1866 during the Austro-Prussian War for the unification of Germany. What Austria lost, Prussia gained. Prussia's actual neutrality was friendly to Russia. It was the beginning of friendship between the two neighbors which secured the Tsar's invaluable support to Prussia 10 years later in her struggle with Austria. Sardinia, Piedmont also joined the war in 1855. It had no interest in the Eastern Question. For the sake of French alliance, it sent 15,000 troops, so that Victor Emmanuel might reign in Rome. The Russian troops crossed Danube in March 1854 and besieged Silistria. The British and French fleets stationed at the Black Sea landed troops at Varna. Austria delivered its first ultimatum to Russia to evacuate the principalities. Omar Pasha bravely led the Turkish defense. With approaching British and French troops, Russia yielded and retreated. Thereupon, Austria occupied the two principalities and remained there for the duration of the war. Sensing Russia's weakness, the Allies put forth four demands, known as the 4 points, on which Russia was to give them satisfaction. Russia was to give up its protectorate over the Danubian principalities. The Danube was to be opened up to foreign commerce. The Straits Convention of 1841, which allowed only Ottoman and Russian warships in the Black Sea, was to be revised. Russia was to abandon any claim, granting it the right to interfere in Ottoman affairs on behalf of Orthodox Christians. Russia hesitated, and in September 1854, the second stage of the war commenced. The Allies thought it necessary to cripple the power of Russia, so that it might not again threaten Turkey. It was decided to capture Sevastopol, the very heart of Russian power in the east. The landing of the Allies in the Crimea was secured by the Battle of Alma in September 1854. Sensing that city was well defended in the north, the Allied army marched southeast. It planned to attack the city from the south. The Russians retreated in the city. The Allied army established port facility at Balaclava for the British and at Kamish for the French. A large Russian assault on the supply base of Balaclava was rebuffed on the 25th of October 1854. The Battle of Balaclava became famous for the action of two British units. At the beginning of the battle, a large Russian cavalry charged the 93rd Highlanders. Commander Sir Colin Campbell abandoned the traditional method of repelling cavalry attack. He formed the 93rd into a line of 2 men deep instead of conventional 4 men deep. He was quite sure of the effectiveness of mini rifles, and he was quite confident that his men would beat back the Russian cavalry. Campbell's tactics proved successful. Times correspondent William Howard Russell saw the Highlanders from a ridge and described the spectacle as a thin red streak topped with steel. This phrase soon became famous as the Thin Red Line. Soon afterwards, the British commander, Lord Raglan, gave written and confusing order to capture the abandoned Russian artillery. Raglan could see those abandoned guns because of his position on the hill. In the valley, that view was obstructed and the wrong guns in sight are left. Earl of Cardigan formed up his unit and charged the length of the valley of the Balaclava under fire from Russian batteries in the hills. The charge of the Light Brigade caused 278 casualties of the 700-man unit. The Light Brigade was memorialized in the famous poem by Lord Tennyson, "The Charge of the Light Brigade." The shortage of men led to the failure of the British and the French to follow up on the Battle of Balaclava, which led directly to the much bloodier Battle of Inkerman. On the 5th of November 1854, the Russians attempted to raise the siege at Sebastopol with an attack against the Allies, which resulted in another Allied victory. The Allies could not seize Sebastopol and settled down to a bitter siege through the Crimean winter. Florence Nightingale achieved her great medical organization at Scutari. A young Russian volunteer, Leo Tolstoy, told stories to his comrades before the campfires. In the spring and early summer, both the Allied and the Russian efforts renewed. After a series of encounters, the Russians blew up the magazines of Sebastopol and surrendered the fortress on September 9, 1855. Apart from military factors, other incidents fundamentally modified the situation during 1855. Palmerston had succeeded Aberdeen as Prime Minister. Sardinia had sent a contingent of troops to the Allies. Austria was playing a double game, and Napoleon III was wavering in the British alliance. Most important of all was the death of Tsar Nicholas in February 1855. The death of Nicholas was not immediately followed by peace. But it was impossible for the new Tsar Alexander II to resist the increasing diplomatic and military pressure. The Russian capture of Armenian fortress of Kars paved the way for a slightly less humiliating surrender. A second Austrian ultimatum proposing terms was accepted. In March 1856, the Peace of Paris was signed. Russia lost her protectorate over the Danubian principalities of Wallachia and Moldavia. They were made self-governing states under Turkish suzerainty and the collective guarantee of the powers. Russia renounced her claim to the protectorate over the Orthodox Christian subjects of Turkey. The Black Sea was declared neutral, and neither Russia or any other power was to have warships there or to maintain arsenals on its shores. The Danube was internationalized and its navigation was thrown open to all the countries. The Russian frontier was withdrawn from the Danube by the cessation of southern Bessarabia. Turkey was admitted to the public law and concert of Europe. The powers collectively guaranteed the independence and territorial integrity of the Ottoman Empire. Turkey, in turn, promised reforms for her Christian subjects. The Peace of Paris may be regarded as offering a satisfactory solution to the Eastern question. Russia was checked and the sick man was set on his legs again. But there was an uneasy feeling that the result obtained were not commensurate with the heavy sacrifices involved. Future events justified this premonition and confirmed the view that Crimean War was the most senseless war of the 19th century. Just 14 years later, Russia threw to the winds the provision concerning the neutrality of the Black Sea. In 1878, she completely wiped away the Crimean humiliation by recovering Bessarabia. The hopes of Turkey reforming itself proved deceptive, and integrity of Turkey became a diplomatic fiction.